Good morning, and welcome back to Good Samaritan Facebook Live. My name is Dr. Scott Stein. I'm a family physician here at Vincennes, Indiana, and Chief Medical Officer of Good Samaritan Physician Network. With me, as always, Adam Thacker, who's our Chief Operating Officer of Good Samaritan Hospital. We'll be giving you our weekly update on where we stand with COVID-19 in our community, talking a little bit about where our numbers have been, where our numbers are now, where we see things going, some updates on visitor policies, a little bit about vaccine update as to what's happening in the community. So, to lead off with, we always talk about total number of cases, somewhere around 3,500 since this all began. But really, the most important numbers we always talk about are those positivity rates. And positivity rate for all individuals is around 2.6% within our community here locally in Knox County, and then just around 10% for the unique individuals. And those are really some of the best numbers that we have seen in the past 4 to 6 months. And then one of the numbers that you updated me on over the weekend was only 18 active cases within our community.
Yeah, truly great trends that we're seeing. And I think if we would have sat here a few weeks ago, even though things were starting to look better, to believe we'd be less than 20 active cases in our community right now, probably would not have taken that bet. So things looking very, very good. And, you know, we get the question now as to what's contributing to this. And so it's certainly multifactorial. It's not one thing, but the vaccine programs are absolutely having an impact, and the high efficacy rates that we've talked about with vaccine, the really strong uptake in our community with going out getting vaccinated when they're eligible, monoclonal antibody treatment and keeping individuals out of the hospital, and then general social distancing, public health measures, really following masking protocols to a high degree have helped to, and the winter months have kept maybe less congregating in areas and more just awareness of that, because we've seen other viral infections really drop off of the normal rates as well. So all good things that we're doing. We kind of approach it still cautiously optimistic. Things are looking good, and there's good potential that this week on the color coding map from the state that we will have moved from that yellow, that we will hit blue, which blue is the no sustained transmission. So that's really where we're moving to. So right now we're in yellow, which is minimal sustained transmission, but there is still that. The 10 plus percent on the unique individual, you'll see a lot from like CDC and scientists that say that 10% mark is kind of the mark. If you're above that, you still need to have a focus on public health measures. As you start to get below 10, then relaxing of restrictions can really open up. I think one thing that we have to remain cognizant of is there is an element of state mandates. There are executive orders in place. So masking, distancing, limitations on how congregate settings are happening at events and that type of thing. We still have to focus, or we still have to follow and be focused on what those guidelines are. And those are being evaluated. You mentioned the visitation policy. So we did make changes to our visitation policy that go into effect today, and we will be allowing one visitor throughout the continuity of care. So from inpatient to outpatient, whether that's outpatient surgery, whether that's in a medical practice, a therapy building, wherever those locations are, you can have a visitor with you for other than just if they're there for medical decision-making, but any visitor. So previously, one visitor inpatient, we did not allow any visitors in the outpatient setting. We've relaxed that to allow that outpatient visitation to happen. And it's something that we continue to look at. We talk about it all the time. There still is an element of keeping traffic down, and that helps us to make sure that we can maintain that distancing. Even if you're coming with a visitor, you're still going to be asked to sit 6 feet apart from other households and follow all those protocols. But as long as we can do that, we hope that we can continue to look at visitation from the eye of how do we relax it further, rather than having to say, well, we relaxed it and now we see some issues and we have to go back in the other direction.
And one of the things that we've spoken about in the past is as those color changes happen throughout our counties, and as of this morning, looking at the most recent few days, we've got a few blue counties that have started to kind of creep in around us. And the exciting thing about that is that we have seen that trend over the course of the past 3 or 4 weeks, where we've gone from red to dark orange to light orange to yellow, and now a few blue blue counties coming in. But the thing that we always speak about is it's important that that needs to stay consistent for a period of time, a few weeks or so. So as we talk about what changes will happen, because everybody wants to know when we're going to be done with masks, when will we be done with masks, when will the restrictions be pulled? And this is not going to happen quickly. This is something we want to see consistent lower numbers. We want to see the issue with community transmission go completely away. And now that we're seeing so few active cases, if we continue to see that, that's one of the driving factors that will keep that us feeling confident that things are going to be good and stay good in a few months.
And on the masking component in particular, I immediately got sent a text whenever Fauci was interviewed and said, in all likelihood, masks are going to continue into 2022. And so that was immediately
crushing.
Yes, it was. I think there are a ton of variables to be determined on that, but the masks are not going away tomorrow. Mm-hmm. When we turn blue, they don't go away. And I think what we have to keep in mind is from the very get-go, we talked a lot about masking. They absolutely decrease transmission from the infected individual to others. They've helped with that other viral spread. And really, there's an element of inconvenience and uncomfortable. They're not unhealthy. They don't put anyone at risk. It's something that we can all do with relative ease. Again, it's a inconvenience, it's uncomfortable, not unhealthy. So they are gonna be around for quite some time. And there will probably be that transition will occur to you should wear a mask if you feel, as masks start to get relaxed, it'll be, you should wear a mask anytime you feel any illness out of an abundance of caution as we move away from some masks. But it's a long ways away. And I think today the easiest response that I have about when are we going to be able to get rid of the mask is we have an executive order from our governor that says we need to wear masks and we need to follow that.
Yeah. And one of the things that Adam alluded to earlier was how well the vaccine program has worked. And each week we talk about how remarkable it is and how many people have been vaccinated. So over 12,000 people have been vaccinated here locally, which is a really significant portion of our population. When we start talking about taking that number as it pertains to what percentage of our population combined with the percentage of our population that has had the illness and has presumed immunity, we are really rapidly approaching that number that makes us feel like that has had a tremendous impact on where we're at with the disease in our county.
Sure. It's not something that can be argued that as the vaccine program rolled out December 17th to today that we started to see that decline. So there certainly has been a community effect in transmission of COVID, and we hope to see that continue to grow. We've given over 12,000 vaccines at Good Samaritan, but then you add on to that our health department, about a month after the Good Samaritan clinic got ramped up and has been vaccinating individuals out at the Community United Methodist Church behind the theater, and more recently, Walmart is now enrolled in a vaccination program and is getting a vaccine, not taking vaccine away from Good Samaritan or the health department, because I get that question. Walmart as a organization is enrolled through the federal program and gets a separate allocation of vaccine going to them, which is a good thing because that means we're bringing more vaccine into the community. And talking to one of their pharmacists, they're ramping up to the capacity to be able to give up to 400 a week as long as they can get supply. And that remains a big deal, is can we get enough supply of vaccine? Last week, the weather had a big impact on that, as it did on everything, including Amazon shipments to the house, to the most important supply maybe in the world right now, the vaccine. But we have been able to continue to get supply, stay ahead of that curve, if you will. Now, what's next is eligibility changes. So we're at 65 and older. It was announced last week that this week we'll go from 65 to 60. Whether that will be today or tomorrow, I think there's a lot of thought that we know that, and we don't. We will find out at the same time that
gets announced, and then we get told sometimes.
Yes. we find out when our system crashes because everybody starts enrolling. That's age 60 to 65. Some anticipation that will happen today, but it will happen this week has been what's been noted, sticking with that age-based. And then following that, will be that 50 to 59 population and starting to look at some of the 50 to 59 that have chronic disease states that are key individuals that can be treated with monoclonal antibody. Those are now those groups, diabetes, heart failure, any pulmonary conditions that will start to move into being able to be vaccinated.
And as Adam mentioned, that monoclonal antibody, although we are using far less of that now, that is still really important to consider for any individuals that become ill, test positive, and especially if you are older than 65, if you have chronic medical conditions. Those are the things we want to know about very quickly. We're still administering that on a routine basis, but we went from delivering somewhere between 10 and 15 of those per day now to maybe one or two per day. But that is a really important thing to not forget about, because that is essentially the treatment for this illness. And if it can be administered early in the course, it has an incredible effect on reducing the complications from the disease, the admission to hospital rate. We've had really fantastic luck with it over the course of the past month or so. And so we're encouraging people, make sure that if you think you're becoming ill, see your primary care provider, get testing done quickly. If you don't have a primary care provider, we do that testing through our community care clinics as well. So make sure that you intervene early, because we have seen the most effective use of that when it's within the first few days of that illness. We'll use it up to 7 to 10 days out, but really the first 2, 3, 4 days of that illness, if you can get identified as a potential candidate and receive that administration that same day or the next day, it goes a great distance for reducing that risk. So kind of where we go from here, of course, we've got spring break that's coming up within a few weeks. We've had really good luck in the last couple of big events that we've had, you know, Super Bowl Sunday and all these other things that we were concerned we would see spikes after. Right. Really, we didn't see much of an increase after any of those. Spring break frequently involves travel to other locations and mixing with people outside of your home group and your normal circle of friends. So we want to encourage people to be cautious about that. That being said, we want people to do normal things and be healthy and be active, because it's been a long year. It's been a difficult year for lots of people. The winter is challenging for people from a depression and anxiety standpoint anyway. Compound that with everything that has happened over the course of the past year, and that makes for a very, very difficult time for folks. So we want you to make plans. We want you to have things to look forward to. But as you're making those plans, it's important to think about what that's going to look like, what you're going to do as you go on your trips or visit people over spring break. So just be cognizant of that and think about what that's going to look like and plan accordingly. We covered vaccines. School, although last week was out for a variety of other non-viral related issues, I think most people are back in session this week. We are, again, proud of our local schools for doing such a great job in managing things. We have seen very low numbers within our school populations. And with vaccinating the teachers being such a success early on, that has had a huge impact in keeping things going. As we move forward, we want to, again, encourage people, just make sure that you continue to be cautious and stay the course. People, as they hear these numbers and counties turning blue, don't give up on things. We want to make sure that people realize that what we're doing now continues to pay dividends over the course of the next few months or so. Any other major issues you want to hit before we go to the phones?
No, I don't believe so. We'll see what questions we have.
A family member age 60 to 64 is a daily caregiver for homebound parents, both 90 years old. Can that family member get the vaccine now as a healthcare worker?
So the exception that's been made for healthcare workers has been if they are providing direct care to somebody on a daily basis as their healthcare provider for somebody that has potentially infectious illnesses going on, whether that's pneumonia or chronic diseases where they would be potentially putting that individual at risk. The best case for that is talk to your primary care provider and make a decision if you would fit into that category. So the state did give some allowance for those caregivers that were providing direct care to an individual on an everyday basis, not as I stop by after work and I check on mom and there's other care going on, but it is that's kind of your sole almost job at this point, that then you fit into that healthcare bucket. Again, you probably have a medical team, a primary care physician or other physicians that are helping take care of your loved one, and you're the care provider with them. So talk it over with them, and if they feel that that's appropriate, then yes, you would go online and register as that healthcare worker.
And that age range that you're speaking about, you know, the 60 to 64, 65 age range, likely that's going to open up this week. As Adam said, we don't have a specific date on that. We would assume that will be today, potentially Wednesday.
Right.
But we would encourage people to be ready for that change to occur.
Okay. This other one, it says, my father is 88 and homebound and very weak. Should he get the vaccine?
Yes, if at all possible, he should get the vaccine. Again, there are multiple places now to get the vaccine administered. I know during certain circumstances, we've been able to go out to people's cars and vaccinate them when they were not able to come in. It's challenging because there are a number of individuals that have those risk factors that are stuck at home. We hope that in the future, there will be mechanisms to get that vaccine administered to them on site as well. Right now, the best avenue would be to have them come, get registered at the hospital facility and be vaccinated here.
Okay. Is there a concern about newer strains of the virus we haven't seen here yet, or are we confident that current vaccines will protect from all strains?
So the very short answer is yes, there's a concern. It's something that we are continuing to watch, and it has a daily minute-by-minute watch at more of a federal CDC type of level. So not to go over all of the detail, but there are really three strains that have been identified. The UK variant is the most notable one, which CDC came out and said higher transmission, that it would be the dominant strain in the United States by March, and it's been doubling in states. It's present in Indiana as well over the last few weeks. What we know about that is that the current vaccines have the same efficacy that they do against the strain that they were developed for. So when we talk about Pfizer and Moderna, 95% efficacy applies to the UK variant. There are two other variants that have different mutations that the vaccine has been tested against that is said to be less efficacious than 95%. But what we don't know is that 75%, is that 80%? There's really just limited data. There are a handful of cases of those in the United States. There have been none identified in Indiana. It's something that is continuing to be watched very, very closely. It is also why we are putting such an emphasis on when you're eligible, get an appointment and get vaccinated, because the race is how fast can the virus mutate into these variants to escape a vaccine versus how fast can we get herd immunity and enough people vaccinated that transmission stops. So if you get enough people vaccinated that transmission stops, mutations stop because you're not spreading the virus. So thus the goal of get vaccinated, roll up your sleeve as soon as you're eligible, find an appointment. We obviously are over 350 a day here at Good Samaritan. If there's an appointment available in 2 days somewhere else, or 2 weeks at Good Samaritan, which we're only about a week out, but just as an example, go to the place for 2 days. We want you to get vaccinated, not just come to Good Samaritan to get ahead of the mutation. So that's the longer answer. The short answer is yes, it's being watched very closely. There certainly is an element of concern. The other key point is, even though we're talking about strains and different variants, nothing changes from a behavioral standpoint. You don't have to wear 5 masks. You don't have to have a stay-at-home order. We need to follow what's working right now, which is wearing a mask, hand hygiene, distancing, being smart about interactions in public settings, and that will help with transmission while we get enough vaccinated to stop the transmission overall.
And one thing that we talk about is protective versus preventive. So I think a lot of people's concept is, if I get the vaccine, I will not get the virus. And that's certainly the hope. However, what we really need to think about is, you know, we talk about being fully vaccinated. You've had your first vaccine, you've had your second vaccine. It's 2 weeks later, we consider you to be fully vaccinated, and the statistics of the studies come into play. But if you had your vaccine 3 weeks ago, 4 weeks ago, there's still some protective effect. If it's a different strain, there's still some protective effect. Now, we don't have all the statistics on that, but the thing to keep in mind is getting vaccinated is helpful. Whether you are fully vaccinated after two vaccines and 2 weeks later, whether it's a different strain, a different variant, more virulent, whatever, it's important to realize that the vaccines are protective regardless. And so that's why it's so important, as Adam said, make sure that you get vaccinated. I had somebody the other day that said that they were waiting to get vaccinated because they were going to wait until they had adapted the vaccine to get the adaptation to the new virus and the new mutation. That is extremely flawed thinking. What we hope to do, as Adam is stating, is if we can shut that spread down and herd immunity, we've talked about that all along, the entire herd does not have to be vaccinated.
Right.
But if a high enough percentage of the herd is vaccinated, it doesn't spread from one to the other, to the other, to the other, and then the entire group is infected. So it's important to realize that the majority of the people, the more people that we can get that can be vaccinated, the more protective it is for everybody.
And to put it in terms of a vaccine that we talk about every year, flu vaccine. So we see every year a flu vaccine comes out, and there are some scientific guesses into mm-hmm. what strains they are vaccinating against. Sometimes it's as little as 20-30% effective. But what we know on the medical side is those individuals that have been vaccinated, even when they get the flu, have a less acute illness. They are less sick. So if you get the vaccine and then these strains do emerge on a more rapid basis and you do contract that and have some illness, there is going to be an antibody response, an immune response that is greater than not having anything at all.
Absolutely.
So as you said, waiting is a very flawed thinking and could lead to serious consequences.
Okay. If travel is absolutely necessary after receiving a dose of the first vaccine, is there any hope of getting the second dose of vaccine in another state?
Sure. Yes. What you will need to do is plan for that. Where are you going? Look ahead to what vaccine is being offered. So as the element of caution is that if you get vaccinated here at Good Samaritan, you will be vaccinated with the Pfizer vaccine. If then you are traveling to Florida, for example, to get away from the winter wonderland, then you are in all likelihood going to be looking at a Moderna vaccine down there. And we've had that issue come up a number of times where people have postponed their trips for 3 weeks to wait till day 21, get the second vaccine, and then go. So they're not interchangeable. But on the flip side of that, I've also had individuals that got Pfizer here, looked ahead, were able to coordinate getting Pfizer at a hospital in another location that they were going to. So yes, that absolutely, you don't have to get both shots at the same place, but you will have to coordinate that the same manufacturer of the vaccine, whether that's Pfizer or Moderna, are what you get for both shots.
And the other thing that's important is different states are doing things differently in terms of what their allocation is, how they are holding back vaccine, what their plans are for the future. So really it's just calling them, talking with the health departments locally where you're going to be. It's important to realize what that's going to look like. And if you have to delay, you have to delay. But in many cases, we've heard people have had success in coordinating those efforts with other health departments in other states.
All right. That's it this morning.
Okay. Any other closing thoughts?
No.
All right. Thank you all for being with us this week, and we'll be with you again next week.